Good morning to all of you. Let me at the outset thank the director and Dr. Manish Gupta and his colleagues for the warm welcome that they have given to us, warm with inverted commas. Well, I was not informed that I should give the keynote address, and suddenly I find that I have to give the keynote address. And already people have spoken about almost about everything about discrete mathematics, ADMA and whatnot. Well, ADMA, as it was pointed out, was started 14 years ago. It was the brainchild of the late lamented Dr. B.D. Acharya, formerly of the Department of Science and Technology, who thought about this organization and also promoted it to a greater extent. So now 14 years have elapsed, and we have been having annual conferences every year. And this year it has been our privilege to visit your institute. We also have the journal, the Indian Journal of Discrete Mathematics, run by ADMA. It has a distinguished array of editors, and shortly, Professor Chaitali Prasad of Georgia Tech, Department of Computer Science and Mathematics and Computer Science, is going to take over as the chief editor with a band of distinguished discrete mathematicians as editors. And I hope the journal will be one of the forefront journals in a very short span of time. Already it has attracted a good many papers, good many mathematicians contributing to it. And I wish that all of you contribute to the ADMA journal on any topic of discrete mathematics. It is very thoughtful of Manish Gupta to have arranged this program for 5 days and allotting 1 day for each topic. Of course, it has its own advantage as well as disadvantage. Advantage is that those who are focused on one particular topic can come and attend and go away. Disadvantage is that they will not be in a position, they are not in a position, or they will not be participating in other events that are being held on other days. So, but sometimes, when you people invite people from industry and all that, they may not be in a position to take a long spell of holidays. And they can come just for 1 or 2 days. And they can give the talks and then be there for a couple of days and go away. That applies even to foreign mathematicians and discrete mathematicians. As it was pointed out by Dr. Ravindra, discrete mathematics has become so all-pervasive. It's almost there in every branch now. Because computers work in discrete steps. That is the basic point. Because computers work in discrete steps, wherever you want to apply computers, naturally, discrete mathematics enters into the picture. All the several areas have been represented in this conference, and I hope you will have a very enjoyable time in this conference. Thank you very much. Well, let me join all of you in wishing Professor Sampath Kumar many happy returns. Well, I am chasing him not only in age, but also in the field of graph theory. But I have not, surpassed him in both, I would say. We were together in launching the Ramanujan Mathematical Society. We were also together in launching the ADMA. The first, inaugural meeting was held some 2004 at Christ College. And since then, we have been working together. And I only appeal to all of you to become members of ADMA if you have not already been there, so that it's become all pervasive, not confined to the southern states, but extends its goal to other states also, so that people from north also come and publish papers and all that. As I told you yesterday, we have the general body meeting, we have made arrangements, we have to revamp the journal and I am sure it will take off as one of the good journals shortly. So I once again thank Dr. Sampath Kumar for making all efforts to launch this ADMA, and it's going on very well, I think. So with these few words, let me wish you again all the best. Thank you. Only graph theory, I will give some proofs also, for perhaps for a change. So I want to talk about some algebraic properties of nodal graphs. Well, so nodal graphs appear in interconnection networks. An interconnection network is represented by a set of interconnected processors, microprocessors having their own memories. Well, it differs from shared memory multi-computers, where communication is done through a shared central memory system. Well, what is broadcasting? Well, information dissemination from one member. You have a group of people and somebody has some information and then you pass it on. This guy passes it on to his next neighbor, and that, so at time zero, only one person knows about it. At time one, two persons know about it. And then each one can pass on the information to one more person. So at time two, two square persons will know like that. So that is a broadcasting. And gossiping, of course, you have a bunch of people where everybody has got some information and they want to pass it on to all the others. That is gossiping. Because I do not propose to talk about these things in detail for the simple reason there is no time. Look at a graph. You have a node, you know, where you have to place, I think it's a processor or a memory or a switch, and the link is the data path between the two nodes. The resulting structure is the interconnection network. Well, we have minimal broadcast networks. So you ask, what is minimal with respect to what? Cost of supporting network, that is the minimal number of communication lines required to complete the broadcast. And then minimum number of calls required to complete the broadcast process. Minimum number of line time units required to complete the broadcast units. So there are three different types of minimality. Okay, so let us not worry about these things because there is not much time. There are n members in the system, the required time is at least the ceiling of log n to the base 2. Because at time t, that if 2 to the power t persons know about it, each one can, you know, transmit a message to a neighbor, and you will have 2 to the power t plus 1 persons will know time t plus 1. So from that you see that there are, if there are n members in the system, the required time is at least log n to the base 2 ceiling. Okay, these are about minimal broadcast network. I just skipped these things for want of time. You have usual topologies where the complete graph, ring graph, that just the, you know, the cycle, and then you have the detorus, the Cartesian product of cycles, then you have the grid graph and so on, and you have the hypercube, it's k, which is k2 Cartesian k2 k times. Number of vertices is 2 to the power k, and each vertex is of degree k, and the diameter is also k. One of the most familiar interconnection network that is used, widely used. And there are other interconnection networks of a similar type, namely the Dubreuil graph, the Coutts graph and so on. They have also been studied. Well, I don't want to go into the detail. If there is time, I will come back and do it. So, a competitor for, a recent competitor for the hypercube HK is the nodal graph WK. So, what about the speciality? The speciality is both the graphs are regular of degree K. Both the graphs have 2 power K vertices. Right, both the graphs have 2 power k vertices and both are regular of degree k. And then why do you prefer nodal graphs to hypercubes? The reason is that you know, you want the information to pass on quickly. So when you want that, naturally the diameter of the graph should be as small as you please, so that, you know, minimum number of steps you can reach all the guys. So the diameter of the hypercube is k, whereas the diameter of the the nodal graph WK is just about k by 2. Exactly, it is ceiling k plus 2 by 2, so it is approximately equal to say k by 2. So, they were originally introduced in 1975 by Knodel, but formally defined and studied only after 10 years by friend Gnard and Peters. So, I will start with the definition of a nodal graph, and I just want to determine the automorphism group of the nodal graph WK. That is my main aim, so to say. And you will see, we have to do a lot of things in order to prove that. So, to start with, I define a general nodal graph W delta M, where you have total number of vertices is N, which of course means that N is even, because mod V1 equal to mod V2 equal to N over 2. It's a bipartite graph. So, first part contains N over 2 vertices, second part also contains N over 2 vertices. I denote the vertices of V1 by I0, I1, I N by 2 minus 1. So, for V1 it is 1, 0, 1, 1, etc. For V2 it is 2, 0, 2, 1, etc. That is the bipartition. So, what are the edges? The edges are, well, I take the vertex 1a, I make it adjacent to 2a, 2a plus 1, like that, but not 2a plus 2, because it, you know, I start from 0, so I take 2 to the power 0 minus 1, which is what? Just 0. Therefore, I have the I0, that 1, 0 vertex is adjacent to 2, 0. Maybe I will show it in the picture, that's better. Look at this graph. I have taken n equal to 14, and the logarithm of 14 with respect to base 2 is 3. I can take, so I can go up to 3. So I have taken delta equal to 3. So each vertex is of degree 3, as you notice it. It's a bipartite graph. And what are the adjacency? How do you define? 1, 0 goes to 2, 0. The 0 is 2 to the power 0 minus 1. And 2, 1, this is 2 to the power 1 minus 1, this is 2 power, so it is not adjacent here, but it is adjacent to 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 3, because 3 is 2 to the power 2 minus 1 and so on, and then finally, there is a 2, 7 is missing, is 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 7. So that is the nodal graph, W3, 14. Okay, I have another nodal graph, which is W38, which is 3, 2 cube, and it is drawn in exactly similar manner, but 1, 0 is adjacent to what? 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 0, 2, 1, and 2, 3. So, it is a cubic graph, each vertex is of degree 3, it is a bipartite, and so on. Every nodal graph is a bipartite graph. So I look at some graphical properties of nodal graphs. Well, nodal graphs are Cayley graphs. The reason is that they are, and therefore they are vertex-transitive graphs. Vertex-transitive means given two vertices, we can always find an automorphism that takes one vertex to another vertex. They are vertex-transitive graphs. That means, you know, the vertices really do not enjoy any special status. We can simply go from one vertex to another by means of an automorphism. But they are not edge transitive. That's a proof given by Fertin and Raspo in the survey paper. In fact, we have also given, they use number theory to prove that, but we have also proved that result, I will show it later, by using just the graph properties. And we also shown it is vertex transitive. So, I look at the recursive construction of this graph. I think I already told you, this is more general, W, okay. I take W26, right? This delta, what is delta? The degree of each vertex. What is that? It is log n with respect to base 2 flow. So, I take instead of n, I take 2n. Then what will happen? It is 1 plus log n, log 2n is log 2 plus log n. So, that is what I have written. So, 1 plus log 2n is 1 plus delta. Therefore, I take one layer here of that graph and another layer here of that graph, and then I put a perfect matching between corresponding vertices. Then I, I blow up that graph from a graph of regular of degree delta to a graph of degree delta plus 1. So, for instance, if you take the graph W2x6, I can get W3x12. So, the 6 vertices will become 12 vertices because I take 2 copies of it and then I have a perfect matching. Therefore, I will have the degree will be blown up by 1. So, the degree of each vertex will increase from 2 to 3. Okay. So, look at this graph. This is W2x6 and another W2x6 I have taken. This is just the same graph as the previous one. Only thing is I have pushed it, laterally. And if I add that, I take a perfect matching. That means I take a square vertex and then a dot vertex here, and then I join it like this. I join it, then I get this graph W3x12. Okay. So, I start from W12, which is K2, just a K2. So, by this iterative construction, I can get what? I can get W12 from W22 square and then from W32 cube and in general WK2 to the power k. Well, these are the graphs that we really, are interested, and because they are the competitors for the hypercube HK of dimension K. So, the Pertin and Raspu, they showed that the Knodel graphs of the hypercube are not isomorphic for k greater than or equal to 4. And we actually present 3 different proofs of that result in our paper, different from what Pertin and Raspu have given. Okay. So, so what do they do? How do they show that? Well, diameter of the hypercube is k and the diameter of the Knodel graph is k plus 2 by 2 ceiling. Therefore, the 2 numbers are different and therefore, the graphs are not isomorphic. That was the proof. So, look, you can have a look at the spectrum. I don't think I will have the time to do that, but if you look at the spectrum, at what time did it start? What time did it start? 9:15? Only graph theory will give some proofs also, perhaps for a change. So, I want to talk about some algebraic properties of Knodel graphs. Well, so Knodel graphs appear in interconnection networks. An interconnection network is represented by a set of interconnected processors, microprocessors having their own memories. Well, it differs from shared memory multi-computers where communication is done through a shared central memory system. Well, what is broadcasting? Well, information dissemination from one member. You have a group of people and somebody has some information and then you pass it on. This guy passes it on to his next neighbor. And so at time 0, only one person knows about it. At time 1, 2 persons know about it. And then each one can pass on the information to one more person. So at time 2, 2 square persons will know like that. So that is a broadcasting. And gossiping, of course, you have a bunch of people where everybody has got some information and they want to pass it on to all the others. That is gossiping. Because I do not propose to talk about these things in detail for the simple reason there is no time. Look at a graph. You have a node, where you have think it's a processor or a memory or a switch, and the link is the data path between the two nodes. The resulting structure is the interconnection network. Well, we have minimal broadcast networks. So, you ask what is minimal with respect to what? Cost of supporting network, that is the minimal number of communication lines required to complete the broadcast. And then minimum number of calls required to complete the broadcast process. Minimum number of line time units required to complete the broadcast units. So, there are 3 different
types of minimality. Okay, so let us not worry about these things because there is not much time. There are n members in the system, the required time is at least the ceiling of log n to the base 2. Because that time t, that if 2 to the power t persons know about it, each one can, you know, transmit a message to a neighbor, and you will have 2 to the power t plus 1 persons will know time t plus 1. So from that you see that there are, if there are n members in the system, the required time is at least log n to the base 2 ceiling. Okay, these are about minimal broadcast network. I just skipped these things for want of time. You have usual topologies where the complete graph, ring graph, that's just the, you know, the cycle, and then you have the D torus, the Cartesian product of cycles, and you have the grid graph and so on, and you have the hypercube, it's K, which is K2, Cartesian K2, K times. Number of vertices is 2 to the power k, and each vertex is of degree k, and the diameter is also k. One of the most familiar interconnection network that is used, widely used. And there are other interconnection networks of a similar type, namely the Dubreuil graph, the Coutts graph, and so on. They have also been studied. Well, I don't want to go into the details. If there is time, I will come back and do it. So, a competitor for a recent competitor for the hypercube HK is the Knodel graph WK. So, what about the speciality? The speciality is both the graphs are regular of degree K. Both the graphs have 2 power K vertices. Right, both the graphs have 2 power k vertices and both are regular of degree k. And then why do you prefer Knodel graphs to hypercubes? The reason is that you want the information to pass on quickly. So when you want that, naturally the diameter of the graph should be as small as you please, so that minimum number of steps you can reach all the guys. So the diameter of the hypercube is k, whereas the diameter of the Knodel graph WK is just about k by 2. Exactly, it is ceiling k plus 2 by 2. So, it is approximately equal to say k by 2. So, they were originally introduced in 1975 by Knodel, but formally defined and studied only after 10 years by friend Gnard and Peters. So, I will start with the definition of a Knodel graph, and I just want to determine the automorphism group of the Knodel graph WK. That is my main aim, so to say. And you will see, we have to do a lot of things in order to prove that. So, to start with, I define a general Knodel graph W delta M, where we have total number of vertices is n, which of course means that n is even, because mod v1 equal to mod v2 equal to n over 2 is a bipartite graph. So, first part contains n over 2 vertices, second part also contains n over 2 vertices. I denote the vertices of v1 by i0, i1, I n by 2 minus 1. So, for v1 it is a 1, 0, 1, 1, etc. For V2, it is 2, 0, 2, 1, etc. That is the bipartition. So, what are the edges? The edges are, well, I take the vertex 1A, I make it adjacent to 2A, 2A plus 1, like that, but not 2A plus 2, because I start from 0. So, I take 2 to the power 0 minus 1, which is what? Just 0. Therefore, I have the I0, that 1, 0 vertex is adjacent to 2, 0. Maybe I will show it in the picture, that is better. Look at this graph. I have taken n equal to 14, and the logarithm of 14 with respect to base 2 is 3. I can take, so I can go up to 3. So I have taken delta equal to 3. So each vertex is of degree 3, as you notice it. It's a bipartite graph. And what are the adjacency, how do you define? 1, 0 goes to 2, 0. The 0 is 2 to the power 0 minus 1. And 2, 1, this is 2 to the power 1 minus 1. This is 2 power. So it is not adjacent here, but it is adjacent to 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 3, because 3 is 2 to the power 2 minus 1 and so on. And then finally, there is a 2, 7 is missing. Is 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 7. So that is the nodal graph, W314. Okay, I have another nodal graph, which is W38, which is 2 cube. And it's drawn in exactly similar manner, but 1, 0 is adjacent to what? 1, 0 is adjacent to 2, 0, 2, 1, and 2, 3. So it's a cubic graph. Each vertex is of degree 3, it's a bipartite, and so on. Every nodal graph is a bipartite graph. So I look at some graphical properties of nodal graphs. Well, nodal graphs are Cayley graphs. The reason is that they are, and therefore they are vertex-transitive graphs. Vertex-transitive means given two vertices, you can always find an automorphism that takes one vertex to another vertex. They are vertex-transitive graphs. That means, the vertices really do not enjoy any special status. You can simply go from one vertex to another by means of an automorphism. But they are not edge-transitive. That's a proof given by Fertin and Raspo in the survey paper. In fact, we have given, they use number theory to prove that, but we have also proved that result, I will show it later, by using just the graph properties. And we also shown it is vertex transitive. So, I look at the recursive construction of this graph. I think I already told you, this is more general. I take W26, right? This delta, what is delta? The degree of each vertex. What is that? It is log n with respect to base 2 flow. So I take instead of n, I take 2n. Then what will happen? It is 1 plus log n. Log 2n is log 2 plus log n. So that's what I have written. So 1 plus log 2n is 1 plus delta. Therefore, I take one layer here of that graph and another layer here of that graph, and then I put a perfect matching between corresponding vertices. Then I blow up that graph from a graph of regular of degree delta to a graph of degree delta plus 1. So, for instance, if you take the graph W26. I can get W312. So, the 6 vertices will become 12 vertices because I take 2 copies of it and then I have a perfect matching. Therefore, I will have the degree will be blown up by 1. So, the degree of each vertex will increase from 2 to 3. Okay, so look at this graph. This is W26, and another W26 I have taken. This is just the same graph as the previous one. Only thing is I have pushed it, laterally. And if I add that, I take a perfect matching. That means I take a square vertex and then a dot vertex here. And then I join it like this, I join it and I get this graph W312. Okay. So, I start from W12, which is K2, just a K2. So, by this iterative construction, I can get what? I can get W12 from W22 square, and then from W32 cube, and in general, WK2 to the power K. Well, these are the graphs that we really, are interested in, and because they are the competitors for the hypercube HK of dimension K. So, the Fertin and Raspu, they showed that the nodal graphs of the hypercube are not isomorphic for k greater than or equal to 4. And we actually present three different proofs of that result in our paper. different from what Perthin and Raspu have given. Okay, so what do they do? How do they show that? Well, diameter of the hypercube is k and the diameter of the nodal graph is k plus 2 by 2 ceiling. Therefore, the two numbers are different and therefore the graphs are not isomorphic. That was the proof. So, look, you can have a look at the spectrum. I don't think I will have the time to do that, but if you look at the spectrum, at what time did it start? What time did it start? 9:15? 9? Okay. So, we also look at the spectrum of the nodal graph WK, and then if you look at the hypercubes and look at the spectrum, you know, it is a Cartesian product of K2, K times K2, Cartesian K2, Cartesian K2 and so on. For K2, the eigenvalues, as you know, are 1 and minus 1. And if you take the Cartesian product, you have to simply add 1 and subtract 1. So, 1, 1, 1 minus 1, 1 minus 1, and here you have 1 minus 1, add 1 to 1 minus 1, add minus 1 to 1 minus 1. So, that will become what? 2, 0 repeated 2 times, minus 2. That will be the spectrum of the next iterated hypercube. Then you do the same thing. You start with the 2, 0, minus 2, that is 2 repeated once, 0 repeated twice, 0, minus 2 repeated once, and then add 1, subtract 1. Like that, you know, whatever may be the number of iterations that you make, they are all integers, positive integers and negative integers and 0. So, for the hypercube, all the eigenvalues are integers, whereas we show that for this graph, WK, that the graph, the nodal graph WK, which is a competitor for the hypercube, there is at least one eigenvalue which is not an integer. Which shows that the two graphs are not isomorphic. That was another proof for showing that the graphs are not isomorphic. Okay. Automorphism group for the nodal graph. So this is the main result of what I am going to speak. Automorphism group. What is an automorphism of a graph? Well, it is a bijective mapping from the suppose G is a graph with vertex at V. An automorphism is just a bijective mapping from V to V, such that UV is an edge of V, if and only if phi U phi V is an edge of G. UV is an edge of G, if and only if phi U phi V is an edge of G. That means the mapping is an automorphism. The automorphisms of a graph form a group, as you know. That is called the automorphism group of the graph. It has been, you know, well studied, and many books on algebraic graph theory will contain chapters on automorphism groups, and you can have a look at it if you are interested in that. So, I take E naught to be the set of zero dimensional edges of WK, the zero dimensional edges of WK. Maybe I will show the picture and then come back to the slide. Look at this, graph here. It has got, it is W4, right? It is W4, and number of vertices is how many? 2 to the power 4. K, WK means number of vertices is 2 power K. For W4, number of vertices is 2 power 4. 16 vertices are there. And I have drawn it. And this is the, you have a perfect matching here. Look at this one, x naught to y naught, x 1 to y 1, x 2 to y 2, x 3 to y 3, etc., etc. Finally, x 7 to y 7. Now, suppose I just remove this perfect matching, what will happen? I remove this perfect matching, what will happen? Well, I will get, you know, the graph will get divided into two parts. Namely, this one here and this one here, they are isomorphic. And they are what? They each will have 8 vertices. And if this is W4, that is W3. So, in general, if you take WK and you remove this particular perfect matching, not any perfect matching, this particular perfect matching, which I call it as E0, you remember? If I remove that, then the graph will break into two isomorphic copies of WK minus 1. Okay. So this is another drawing of the same graph, which is required for certain purposes. The same graph we are redrawing. Okay, now I go back. Okay. So I remove this. This is W4 and two copies of W3. So this is W4. The whole thing is W4. If I remove it, what? I get W3 here. This is also a nodal graph, W3. And this is also a nodal graph, W3. So, W4 and the two copies of W3 in W4 minus E0. The general case also you will have the same thing that what was written before. Anyway, we need it. WK minus E0 consists of, this is missing, two copies of WK minus 1. You call them WK minus 1 1 and WK minus 1 2. So, you have the vertex of that WK minus 1 1. Well, it is xk minus 1, yk minus 1, you know. So, this is, you have xk minus 1, here yk minus 1, here xk minus 1, another yk minus 1. So, from dimension k, it gets reduced to dimension k minus 1, but along more or less the same, on the same pattern, not more or less, exactly on the same pattern. Okay. Now, the main result which enables to compute the automorphism group of the nodal graph is the fact that E0 is the only perfect matching of W0 such that it has this property that if you remove the WK minus E0 consists of two isomorphic copies. That is, there are several perfect matchings, but it is the only perfect matching that has the property that if you remove it, then the graph gets divided into two isomorphic copies of nodal graph dimension 1 less. So, I just maybe I will briefly indicate the problem. I won't go into all details. By contradiction, suppose we assume that the vertex set of WK is x0, y0 and the E0 equal to x0, y0, etcetera. If possible, there is another perfect matching E0 prime with that property. Namely, when you delete it, you have WK minus 1 prime and WK minus 1 double prime. And let the vertex set of this one be this, the partitioned vertex set. That is also a bipartite graph. Similarly, the vertex set of this graph is this one, also a bipartite graph. All right. So, I have drawn the picture. I have two cases. I consider the two cases. I just mentioned one case and leave out the other one. There are x0 and y0, the corresponding vertices are different components of, because you remove e0 prime, your assumption is you remove e0 prime, the graph, gets decomposed into or divided into two isomorphic copies. So, I take this x0, y0. I assume that they are in different components. Well, if x0, y0 are in different components, as removal of e0 prime disconnects WK into two components, y1, y3, y3, etcetera must all be in y1 prime. They must all be in y1 prime. So, y1 prime means it is that one here. Okay, as y0 x1 is in WK, y0 x1 is y0 is here, x1 is here, y0 x1 is in WK, y0 x1 is not in e0 prime, y0 x1 is not in e0 prime because we already assumed that y0 x0 is in e0 prime. So, the matching edges will not meet and therefore, x1 y1 belongs to e0 prime. So, from that you conclude that x1 here and y1 there must be also an edge of this matching e0 prime. Already x0, y0, we started with the case that x0, y0 is in e0 prime. Now, you have proved that x1, y1 is in e0 prime. This way, you continue that every edge of e0 is an edge of e0 prime. Therefore, E naught and E naught prime are the same, which means that E naught is the only perturbation thing which when removed will give you two copies like this. Similarly, we can prove the case when X naught and Y naught on different components of WK minus E naught prime, but that is more tedious, so I just leave it out. So, what is the corollary to this result? The corollary is WK is not isomorphic to HK. Well, Pertidon and Raspoo proved that they are not isomorphic by showing that the diameters are different. But we show that they are not, WK is not isomorphic to HK because of this property. There is one, the perfect match, the only perfect matching that divides into two isomorphic copies is E naught. Suppose I take the hypercube. For example, you take just a 3 cube, for instance, you have the box 3 cube. Well, you cut it out here, you get two copies. You cut it out vertically, you get two isomorphic copies. So, for the hypercube, there are several, more than one, perfect matching, which when removed will give you isomorphic copies, but not for the nodal graph. Okay. So, the every automorphism takes an edge of dimension 0 to an edge of dimension 0. Dimension 0 means x naught to y naught. That is an edge of dimension 0. X naught to y 1 means dimension 1. Like that, you know. So, x naught to y 3, that is a dimension 2. So, because it is 2 square minus 1. So, 3 is 2 square minus 1. So, every automorphism takes an edge of dimension 0 to an edge of dimension 0. So, because you know it takes only an edge of dimension 0 to an edge of dimension 0, an edge of dimension 0 cannot be mapped to an edge of dimension 1 by means of an automorphism, right? Because every edge of dimension 0 goes only to an edge of dimension 0. So, edge of dimension 1 will not go to an edge of dimension 1. Any edge of dimension 0 cannot be taken to an edge of dimension 1 by means of an automorphism, which means what? The graph is not edge-transitive. Edge-transitive means given any two edges, it is possible to find an automorphism that takes one edge to the other edge. So that is not the case here. So this again, Raspoo and Pertidon, they proved it by a different method, but then it comes as a byproduct of our result. So what is the consequence? Well, the consequence is this, you have a WK, you chop off this E naught, you get one copy WK minus 1, which we call the upper layer if you want, and one copy of WK minus 1 lower layer. So, upper layer, lower layer, they are connected by means of a perfect matching E naught. So, alpha takes an edge of E of dimension, so in the top layer, I take an edge of dimension 0. I take an edge of dimension 0. Alpha takes an edge of dimension 0 of the top layer to an edge of dimension 0 of the bottom layer, because any edge of dimension 0 in the top layer is of dimension 1 in the whole graph. So, here is the proof for that result. So, suppose I assume that okay, I think we can skip this. Okay. So, I take an automorphism alpha in the whole nodal graph. What does it do? Well, it either, you have the top layer and the bottom layer. Well, it either fixes the top layer and fixes the bottom layer, or else it just permutes them, interchanges them. So, that is the result. So, suppose I take V in the top layer and alpha V is a vertex W in the top layer. The top layer is also a nodal graph, so it is connected. Therefore, there is a path going from V to W, which we may call it as say V, etc., WPV. So, WP, where is WP? It is in the, Thank you. three phase. So I take an edge of the top layer and let phi of that E naught be the top layer, be the second layer. Then that E naught 1 is a perfect matching of WK 1. So E naught 1 means in the E naught in the top layer, that is zero dimensional edges of the top layer. Therefore, E is a perfect matching. And a perfect matching goes to a perfect matching, therefore E naught 2 is a perfect matching of WK 2. But you know that WK minus E naught prime is a disjoint union of two copies of WK minus 1. We have proved that before, which implies that WK 2 minus E naught 2 is a disjoint union of two copies of WK minus 1, 2. So which shows that E naught 2 is the set of zero dimensional edges of this. Because any perfect matching, if removed, it gets two copies, then it means that perfect matching must be the set of zero dimensional edges that you have proved. Okay. I take an automorphism alpha of WK, the nodal graph. All these are applicable only for k greater than or equal to 4. Then alpha either fixes both the top layer or the bottom layer, or else it interchanges them. Alpha fixes the bottom layer on the top layer, or else it interchanges them. So the proof is given for that. So any automorphism, what does it do? It fixes both the layers, or interchanges the two layers. Then what? If alpha is an automorphism of WK, then if alpha is an automorphism on the top layer, if alpha is the identity on the top layer, then it must be the identity in the whole graph. So you have a WK, the top layer, and the bottom layer. Suppose you take an automorphism of the whole graph. Suppose the automorphism, you know, it fixes it is the identity automorphism. That means each vertex of the top layer is fixed. Then each vertex of the bottom layer is also fixed. Because, from this vertex in the top layer, there are k edges going, all the k minus 1 neighbors are fixed. Therefore, because it is an automorphism, the neighbor set will be fixed. So, the other neighbor will be in the bottom layer. Therefore, the last vertex, that will also be fixed, which means that the whole bottom layer will also get fixed. So, what is the conclusion? If you have two automorphisms that agree on the top layer, they must agree on the whole graph. If there are two automorphisms on the nodal graph that agree on the top layer, then they must be the same. They must agree on the whole graph. So, then almost we are closing in. So, what is alpha? Alpha is an automorphism of the nodal graph. If alpha fixes some vertex of WK, suppose alpha fixes some vertex of WK, then alpha must be the identity automorphism. If an automorphism fixes just a single vertex, then it must be the identity automorphism. So, I can assume without loss of generality, alpha fixes the first vertex, because it is a vertex-transitive graph. All vertices have similar properties. So, I can assume that W fixes, alpha induces an automorphism which fixes X naught. In this case, we can show, the previous result, if it fixes X naught, then it is the identity automorphism. You know, stage by stage I come down, it says the identity automorphism is over there, then I take the identity automorphism over there, and then I come down to the next layer, and then to the next layer, and finally, I have alpha is the identity automorphism on the nodal graph W4. But W4 is a small nodal graph dimension 4, and actually you can compute the automorphisms. It's not easy, but you can actually compute the automorphisms and then show that it is the identity automorphism, and then you backtrack. Well, if it is an identity on the one layer, then it is identity on the whole graph you have said. So from alpha W4 you go to W5, then W6, and so on and so forth, and finally WK. and you conclude that it is the identity automorphism on WK. Okay. All right. So almost we have come to the final leg to determine the automorphism group in our attempt to determine the fix the automorphism group for the nodal graph WK. I take A to be the automorphism group of WK. So what is it? Well, we have characterized it to be the dihedral group D 2 to the k minus 1. Dihedral group DL means you take a regular polygon of n size and you consider all the symmetries of that polygon. So if it is a polygon of n size, then it will be of order 2n. So here that you denote it by dn. Dn is of order 2n. So here the dihedral group is of order d n over 2, that is d 2 to the k minus 1, which is of order 2n, which is equal to 2k. Well, suppose I take alpha. Alpha in that group, automorphism group, and let us suppose that alpha moves A to B. Then you take phi to be the automorphism. You know, we have seen that phi is an automorphism. X naught, it takes, you know, cyclically rotates. X naught goes to X1, X1 goes to X2, X1 minus 1 goes to X naught. Similarly, correspondingly, Y naught goes to Y1, etc. So that is an automorphism. And then the interchange x naught and yn minus 1, x1, yn minus 1, xn minus 1 to y naught. That also is an automorphism. I showed it in various pictures there. So that is an automorphism. So if I take the composition of these two automorphisms, you find that is actually the dihedral group of order 2 to the power k. So this group acts transitively on the vertex at the WK. That means you take any two vertices of WK, I can find an automorphism that takes that vertex to this vertex. Okay. Suppose the vertices are say x0 to x5. Well, I apply phi repeatedly. Phi will take x0 to x1, phi square will take x0 to x2, and so on. So x0 will go to some x5. Similarly, y0 can be taken, or y, any y can be taken to any other y by means of iteration. And I want to go from x to y. Any vertex can be taken to any other vertex. Means if I want to go to x, y, apply psi. And if I apply psi, I come down from x to y here, and then I apply phi, I can move along y's. So any x I can be taken to any x j. Therefore, this group acts transitively on the vertex set of W k. Let alpha belong to that group A, this group here, and let us suppose that alpha A equal to B for some A in B. That is alpha max. Alpha is an automorphism. Alpha maps the vertex A to the vertex B. But A goes to B means, because I told you this acts transitively, there exists an automorphism B in that group A, in that group generated by phi and psi, such that beta A equal to B. Because it acts is a transitive group. Oh. Okay. Therefore, there is a beta in that group generated by phi and psi, such that beta takes A to B because it acts transitively. Therefore, what is beta inverse B? It is A. So, if I take alpha beta inverse B, it is alpha A, but alpha A is B. Therefore, alpha A is B. which means that alpha beta inverse fixes some B. But you know that if an automorphism fixes some vertex, that is the identity automorphism on the whole graph. Therefore, alpha beta inverse is the identity automorphism, which means that alpha beta inverse equal to identity, which means alpha equal to beta. So, you see that we started with some automorphism alpha and then proved that it is, started with an automorphism A in A, and then we proved that it is equal to beta, where beta belongs to this. But the other way, inclusion is obvious because everything here is an automorphism. Therefore, it is contained in the automorphism group. Therefore, the automorphism group is the group generated by phi and psi. Well, what is the consequence of this? It gives immediately that the automorphism group of the graph, it is the dihedral group d 2 to the power k minus 1. So, it is of order 2 to the power k. This also gives another proof that the hypercube is not the same as the Knodel graph, because the automorphism group of the hypercubes have been computed by Harari several years back. Automorphism group, what is that? Yeah, one and same. That is why we take k greater than or equal to 4. Up to k equal to 3, they are one and the same. Right side. Everywhere I write k greater than or equal to 4, that's the reason. But to determine the automorphism group of the hypercube, you start with the result of Harari from here, for the hypercube H3. And then you iterate it, you will get the 2 to the power k factorial k, that will be the size of the automorphism group. 2 to the power k factorial k, that will be the size of the automorphism group or the hypercube, whereas there is something different here. So, that way also you show that the two graphs are not isomorphic. Okay, so finally, I determine the spectrum of Knodel graphs. Already, Swami Vaidya mentioned about the spectrum of a graph. So, what is the spectrum? Well, you take the adjacency matrix of the graph with respect to any ordering, because you take a different ordering, they will become symmetric, similar matrices. Similar matrices are the same spectrum. Therefore, you take the adjacency matrix of that graph and you find out the spectrum. Well, the adjacency matrix will look like this, because this is for the upper layer. There it is an bipartite graph. So, top layer is independent, bottom layer is independent, and we have, so the whole thing is 0 here. It is 2 to the power k minus 1, 2 to the power k minus 1, and here it is a circulance, because x naught is adjacent to y naught, x naught is adjacent to y 1, x 1, x naught is adjacent to y 3, and so on. And then when you shift it to x 1, similar thing happens. So, it is a circulant matrix. So, you look at this, where see the circulant of order 2 to the k minus 1, and having first row equal to this, and it has 1 in the 2 to the power j minus 1 to position. So, the question is, you have to compute the spectrum of this graph, this matrix. This graph is the same thing as the spectrum of this matrix. So, any circulant is a normal matrix. Normal means a matrix is called the normal if it commutes with the transpose. So, any circulant is a normal matrix that you can check. So let's see, be a circulant in the first row, C naught, C 1, C n minus 1, then the spectrum of C is of this type, C naught plus C 1. I take a circular means what? 1, 2, 3, 3, 1, 2, 2, 3, 1. You write down the first row, you cyclically shift it, A naught, A 1, A n minus 1, then A n minus 1, A naught, A 1, A 2, etc. Then A n minus 2, A n minus 1, A naught, etc. All the diagonal entries will be the first entry, namely A naught. That's a circulance. So, use the fact that any circulant can be expressed by this one, where the Z is the matrix 0, 1, the circulant 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0. 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, you cyclically, you repeat it, you know, then you get that. So, from that you get, if A is this matrix, then the spectrum of A, you have, that is equal to this theorem. From that you get, you can deduce this, that the spectrum of WK 2 to the power K is, you know, you have some, the omega is not W but omega. The omega is 2 to the power 2 pi I by 2 to the k minus 1, the root of unity. And then you sum this and then you take the absolute value and you have got 2 to the power k roots. They are all the eigenvalues of this nodal graph, where omega is this one. Okay, I have given the proof for that. Now, with the simple manipulation, you show that for k greater than or equal to 4, this square root of k square minus 6 k plus 10 belongs to that spectrum. That requires some manipulation. So, this is the manipulation in fact. You take t equal to this and omega etcetera etcetera, you have this and you get the root of k square minus k 6 k plus 10. That is in the spectrum of the nodal graph. So, that is in the spectrum of the nodal graph means what? Nodal graph is not an integral graph. The graph is called the integral if all the eigenvalues are integers. Hypercube is an integral graph. Whereas, this one is not an integral graph, but because the square root of k square minus 6 k plus 10 is never an integer. So, what is the conclusion? You have the hypercube, all the eigenvalues are integers, you have the nodal graph. There is at least one eigenvalue which is not an integer. Therefore, they can never be isomorphic. In that way, we have several proofs for the fact the hypercube and the nodal graph are not isomorphic. So, these are the references. I think 1975, I think I showed it to you. No, Knodel himself introduced it. Then afterwards the trigonal and there is he showed it in the. Yeah, But I don't think anybody has studied applied it to coding theory. As far as my knowledge is.
So, normally graph complement is defined with respect to complete graph.
Yeah.
So, but we can generalize the definition of graph complement, meaning that if you have a graph G and a graph H, the complement of H with respect to G is from the, instead of from complete graph, from G you delete H and you get something.
Yeah, you mean H is a subgraph of G?
Yeah, H of course, sorry, okay. H is a subgraph of G. So, okay. In that case, yeah. We have this normal theorem that G1 is isomorphic to G2.
Which one isomorphic?
If and only if G1 complement is isomorphic to G2 complement.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't, that arises in the context of the fact that you said that there is only one perfect matching.
Yeah, yeah.
Obviously, any two perfect matchings are isomorphic.
Mm-hmm.
But when you remove one perfect matching, you get two copies of W, whatever.
In fact, only for E0 that happens.
Right.
It gets divided into two isomorphic copies.
So,
for any other perfect matching, it doesn't happen.
Right. That's what that is almost like graph complement. These two are isomorphic, but the complement is not.
Mm.
So, we know it holds a complete graph. Is there any other graph where if two graphs, subgraphs are isomorphic, then the complement is isomorphic? It's a Or is it just proper? I mean, obviously it requires some symmetry, but is there anything like that known?
I don't know. Well, you can tell any of you. I don't know.
Because that arises immediately, that question arises the moment you mentioned that you are moving perfect matching, but only one of them results in.
You mentioned some generalized complement some time back, right? Sorry, Sambat Kumar? You mentioned some generalized complement of a graph.
Yes, yes, yes.
No, that is the result of perfect matching. But I am saying you generalize the question. Any subgraph, the complement.
You just briefly tell, what is that about? Generalized the complement.
Generalized complements, you know, you take a partition of the graph, arbitrary, remove the lines in between the sets, add the missing lines. That is called K complement, where K is the number of sets in the partition. That is one type of generalization. Another one is, in each set, remove the lines, add the lines, in each set, don't touch the in between the same. So that is called IK complement.
But that's not what you are referring to now.
No, mine is generalize the notion of complements, which and see, is there apart from complete graph where we have a simple theorem, G is isomorphic to H if and only whatever G1 is isomorphic to G2 if and only G1 bar is isomorphic to G2 bar. Sorry, keep getting sloppy the symbols. So similarly, is there some other graph where if we define the notion of complement, then the same result is true. So if some subgraph of the graph is isomorphic to as to another subgraph, then the complements are also isomorphic. So it was obviously not true in general because of the example of you are removing only one perfect matching, you get two copies of W to K minus 1. W is a convenient worldwide web.
That's why I say top layer, bottom layer.
Bottom layer. So clearly in that case doesn't hold. So I was just wondering whether there's any other graph.
No.
So interesting open question if it's open.
Yeah.
Or if someone knows it.
So let us thank the speaker if we have no other questions. The stage question.
Well, I just want to say thank you to all of you, Dr. Manish Gupta and his wonderful team of volunteers and their colleagues. All the arrangements have been taken care of, you know, in a very nice manner. A reception, food, accommodation, transport, and whatnot. I know I have myself arranged several conferences. All of these people have arranged a lot of conferences. I know how difficult it is to arrange a conference, but still we keep organizing conferences, and it is really a wonderful event that we have had. And the last 2 days is a sort of a departure for us and something new that we have not been accustomed to having it, the ADMA conferences. But anyway, it was a very welcome and a delightful experience for all of us. So thank you very much for all of you. To all of you, I extend my hearty thanks on behalf of ADMA. Thank you so much. Goodbye. And I expect you to become members of ADMA if you have not already become. And also try to attend the next annual conference and earlier conferences. Next annual conferences, as it was mentioned, it will be in Christ University in Bangalore. So if there may be earlier conferences and workshops also, if you are a member, you can go to the website and you can have a look at it and you will get the information. Thank you so much. Bye.
Well, let me join all of you in wishing a professor Sampath Kumar many happy returns. Well, I am chasing him not only in age but also in the field of graph theory, but I have not surpassed him in both, I would say. We were together in launching the Ramanujan Mathematical Society. We were also together in launching the ADMA. The first inaugural meeting was held some 2004 at Christ College. And since then, we have been working together. And I only appeal to all of you to become members of ADMA if you have not already been there, so that, it's become all pervasive, not confined to the southern states, but extends its goal to other states also, so that people from north also come and publish papers and all that. As I told you yesterday, we have at the general body meeting, we have made arrangements, we have to revamp the journal, and I am sure it will take off as one of the good journals shortly. So I once again thank Dr. Sampath Kumar for making all efforts to launch this ADMA, and it's going on very well, I think. So with these few words, let me wish him again all the best. Thank you.